I had somebody make a comment to me during the week. I don't always wear this when I'm inside the church building. Those that might see me during the week, sometimes I walk around in jeans and a t-shirt, and sometimes it's appropriate. I don't really feel like going up and fixing light bulbs in my suit. It doesn't go down very well. But I wear t-shirts and t-shirt and some jeans sometimes. And what was interesting was somebody actually made a comment to me. Nobody here at this church, I hasten to add. And somebody actually made these comments and said, "You're off duty then, you're not at work today, you're on holiday." No, I've got to go into work. And I just thought, so I'm off duty just by the clothes that I'm wearing, am I? Are you off duty when we don't wear our correct clothing during the week? Do we go off duty when we walk out of this building?
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Chip Off the Old Block, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 to 5, by Pastor's Assistant Warren McNeil.
Okay, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 to 5. And as it reads, "As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God, and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ." Verse 5 of that is the, if you must know, most of us must recognise that now. It was from the New Year's Eve, even when David was speaking. It's the, want a better phrase, one of the church mottos for this year. Do we recognise it? Yeah, absolutely. It's been spoken on a number of times, and it's on the front of the church magazine. And sooner or later, there's going to be some banners up, one up there and one on the other side with it on there, as well as a reminder. I was hoping to get it up there this week. Unfortunately, logistically, it wasn't going to happen. That's concrete up there, so I noticed. So anyway, so drawing pins are not going to work. But it will get up there. But I don't know about you lot, I look at this and I think, oh yes, great, living stone. Yep, understand that, it's about Jesus. And he was rejected by men, but chosen by God, and living stones. Oh yeah. And there's a few key phrases in here, I think sometimes, honestly, what do they mean? Am I the only one on that? Do you occasionally read that and just think, what is the deeper meaning behind some of that? And this morning, I just want us to go through some of those, just a few of the key phrases that are in there. And I feel that's just what God wants us to do this morning. Well, let's go with living stone, or in verse 5, living stones. Now, it's unusual to really think about a stone that's living. Most of the stones in my garden don't look particularly animated to me. I don't walk up to them and have a chat with them. They don't particularly feed on the plants. As far as I can make out, it's our slugs and snails that are doing feeding on our plants. According to Joy, she comes screaming in, moaning about one of her many plants in our garden that's being destroyed at the moment. But living stone. It says that we are living stones. Like living stones, we are. Do you feel like a living stone? Do you feel like a stone? You might do after a hearty dinner. You might sit on the sofa after a while and go, whoa, over it, especially at Christmas time. Yeah? So you can admit to the fact that sometimes you do overeat. You know, that, you know, you're meant to confess your sins, by the way. So gluttony, I know, is one of them. But sometimes you can sit and feel a bit like a heavy stone. But a living stone, what does that mean? Well, the Greek for stone that was used here, it's interesting. There's many different words for stone in New Testament Greek. But the particular one that was used here was used for a shaped stone, one that has been designed to fit into a building. It is a, for want of a better word, chiseled, moulded, hewn stone. So it's shaped. It looks like a brick. If we want to use one of our own analogies, it looks like these various bricks that we have here. These have all been shaped. Shaped into a uniform size so that this building can stay standing. And it stays standing fairly well. Celebrating the anniversary of the church as a whole, which is not the building, but the church as a whole, and this building after the war. And so it's holding up quite well, isn't it? Because some brick shapers shaped them in the right size, in the right design, that they could hold up the building. So the word here, the Greek word for stone here, was actually used as a shaped stone. Had to fit in the right slot. And sometimes we don't get that. I think when we think stone, we do think a lump. I do anyway. I think Brighton Beach. There's lots of stones on Brighton Beach. Some are nice and big, some are very little small, and hurt as you walk further down into the sea. So much so now I'm a wimp. I wear sort of shoes that can wade into the sea with them so they don't hurt my little tootsies. But that's what you can think. So actually, no, what was getting here in 1 Peter was that it is a shaped stone. It has been designed and shaped to go into a, for this particular staying, a building. But it's a living stone, so it's not static. These are all static. If these stones weren't static and got up and moved, there wouldn't be much of a building left, would there? The slightest, and it go over. Some may think that's not a bad thing. We might need them to go so we can rebuild them out a bit wider. But it is a living stone that is being spoken about here. And we are like living stones. We are shaped. We are being shaped so that we can be alive. So that we can fit into the right slot within the church. Do you feel like a shaped stone at the moment? You also like living stones are being built into a spiritual house. Spiritual house. Well, there's another one of those descriptive comments that I think, what does a spiritual house look like? I know what a house looks like. Does everybody here know what a house looks like? Yeah? You don't? Okay. A house, it's made of bricks, normally, in this country anyway, than all we are. Made of bricks, and they have a roof over them, and they're fairly static, and they sit. And they cost a lot more money. They didn't cost as much money as they did maybe 3 years ago, or 2 years ago. They cost a little bit less at the moment due to recession, which is useful. But, you know, that's a house. And it's static, and it doesn't move anywhere. It's solid. Should, hopefully, if it's been built correctly, it's solid. But it doesn't go anywhere. So what's a spiritual house? Well, spiritual house to me is more like a caravan. It's mobile. It's not static. It's okay. It can be mobile. It's not static. It doesn't sit in one place. Spirit of God moves, doesn't he, everywhere? Yeah? He hovers on waters, over waters. He lives inside of us. And he's moving everywhere. We are the spiritual house, church. Not these bricks, but it's us. But a house is a place where you can come and be, isn't it? People are invited in. If your house are sort of, you know, fairly same as mine, it's warm. Actually, it's more warm now. We had central heating replaced 2 weeks ago. It's amazing. Just in time for this hot weather, our central heating works properly. It's great. But it's warm, and it's not just the central heating. We're quite warm and inviting as a family, we hope, aren't we, love? Yeah. But it's warm, and, you know, but that is the spirit, that is the house that we are meant to be as a church. We are meant to be warm, inviting. And one of the many comments we get from visitors when they fill in the visitor's form is, it's warm and welcoming and friendly, and thank you. And that's good. And I'm pleased that as a house of God, we are warm and inviting. But what goes before that house is spiritual. And the spirit comes from God. It's got nothing to do with us as individuals, as people. It's to do with God. And we need to remember that, I would suggest sometimes. So we're being built into this spiritual house. This house that first and foremost is God-focused. Also with spiritual houses, you can't see what sometimes is going on with them. My house, you can see what's happening with it. My house at home, you can see clearly what's happening with it. You can clearly see where housework's not been done. You can click. I'm not having a go at Joy at all, Andy. I was talking about myself. You can see where some of the rot is setting in on some of our windowsills because I've not done the maintenance work. It's clearly seen. But a spiritual house, last chunk of the spiritual side of it, we can't physically see with our eyes. You can see some of the good works that come out of it, but we can't always see everything with our physical eyes. What you also can't see is when it's changing and shifting sometimes that easily, allowing for new people to come in. A spiritual house, a mobile house, it allows for extension. It moves and allows for new people to come in and to be part of that house. And we're in the process of doing that, aren't we? We've got people coming and being added to the membership every members meeting. And they are people coming with gifts and talents and new sets of bricks, new sets of stones that we adjust and change for and allow to slot in, because that's what we're called to do. And we don't all look the same. These bricks, one half look the same colour as the other half, yeah? So they look the same. We don't look the same. Andy Crane, would you mind just coming up the front briefly, please? Thank you. Andy's fully aware of this. I warned him literally 30 seconds before I was going to start. Andy and I do not look the same, do we? No, he's considerably better looking than me. Yes, Richard, yes, he is. That's fine. But we do not look the same. We're not the same height. Can you? No, you can't. No. Don't worry. Right. We're not the same width. We do not look the same. Yet, we slot into this house. If the bricks were like me and Andy, everything would be on a tilt. And it doesn't look like that. Thank you, Andy. That's great. Because we're all different and we have different gifts and some of them are not easily seen. And we have to appreciate that sometimes. Like living stones, you are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. David's done lots of teachings on this, about being us being a priesthood, and given us references in the Old Testament, especially in Exodus. We do all that teaching on Exodus. Do we remember that, those of us that hear for it? And about being a priesthood and what it was to be a Levite, to be in the priesthood. And within that description, there was a lot of description about what the priests wear, their garments. Yeah, do we remember that, everybody? And all the different things and what they meant. And they had to put these garments on because they were priests, and therefore then they were recognised as such by the people around them. Does anybody here wear a priestly garment as such? I don't. I know these days I wear a suit now on a Sunday morning, but that's about as close as I get to even looking like I'm on duty. But some of us actually sometimes put on our garments to make our outward look good. And this is what these priests did. So they were easily recognised by their clothing that they wore. What about a holy priesthood? I thought that was quite something this morning with Andy Robertson, and I thought he was absolutely right to stop and make us focus on those words. Holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. I think God was trying to point out something to us very clearly, that he is holy, and he calls us to be a holy priesthood. What does that mean? What does holy mean? And that's the question. Clean hands, pure heart. Anybody else? God is without sin, yes. And we're without sin through Jesus Christ. We still sin, but we are forgiven in grace. Yeah, thank you. To be separated, thank you, yeah, that's it. To be set apart, to be different. To be different. The priesthood were able to have their garments on and look like they were set apart. Doesn't mean that their insides were set apart. Doesn't mean their heart was set apart. It could have still been of the world. We are asked and chosen to be set apart, to be holy. We are set apart through Jesus Christ, but how often are we living a holy life? Because we are called not just to look good from the outside. And that's the thing about being a spiritual house. As I said, you can't see all the things that are going on. I had a bit of a joke with someone this morning. They were going on about how fine they were. I'm not denying that they're not fine. I'm not saying they're not. But we just sort of said that sounded like that typical Sunday morning smile. I'm fine. Or, I'm fine, and for 6.5 days a week I live my own life, but when I'm here on church on Sunday morning, I look holy. Yeah? I had somebody make a comment to me during the week. I don't always wear this when I'm inside the church building. Those that might have seen me during the week, sometimes I walk around in jeans and a t-shirt. And sometimes it's appropriate. I don't really feel like going up and fixing light bulbs in my suit. It doesn't go down very well. But I wear t-shirt and some jeans sometimes. And what was interesting was somebody actually made a comment to me. Nobody here of this church, I hasten to add. And somebody actually made this comment and sort of said, "You're off duty then? You're not at work today? You're on holiday?" No. I've got to go into work. And I just thought, so I'm off duty just by the clothes that I'm wearing, am I? Are you off duty when we don't wear our correct clothing during the week? Do we go off duty when we walk out of this building? And I was like, no, I'm going to work. They did look at me quite shocked. There you go. Excuse me a moment. I must explain, if I look like I'm bending down a lot, it's I put out my back on Friday night. I spent most of yesterday laid up on the sofa, so I'm a little bit stiff this morning. It seems to be all right at the moment, so I apologise if I suddenly grimace too much. Yeah, we are to be holy on the inside, not on the outside. How do we become holy on the inside? What makes us not holy? There's a better question. What makes us not holy? Sin, nice all-encompassing word. What can that mean, though? Let's break that down a little bit further, shall we? It means we have to actually maybe delve into our own thoughts and thinkings at the moment.
Try to love your neighbour and do good things.
I missed that, sorry.
I said try to love your neighbours. Your neighbours.
Like to be holy, yeah, to try and love our neighbours, do is one of those commandments. But what can infect into our lives that makes us not so clean? Sophie?
Unforgiveness.
What, us not forgiving somebody else? Yeah, absolutely.
doing Caleb. Our will, not God's will.
Yeah, thank you, Caleb. Doing our own thing rather than God's thing. Very much so. Disobeying God and disobeying people. Yeah? Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Rachel, sorry. So what we watch on TV, what we listen to, what we read, basically the stuff that's maybe not as pure as it should be. Thank you. Absolutely. Selfish. Sorry? Selfishness, yeah? That can make us not holy. Very true. Thank you. Yeah, these things can come in and pollute. And they do. They can come in and pollute. I want to go back to that stone analogy, please. You living like living stones in verse 5. I want to just go back to that for a moment. Because I said to you, do you feel like a stone at the moment? Do you feel like you're being shaped? Let's take the stones. Let's take these stones in these buildings. Let's just look at these visually just for a moment. They would have come out of the rock and out of the ground, not shaped looking like that, would they, initially? I would suggest. I don't know about anybody else here. Have you ever, ever had to take a stone to get it to fit into a gap somewhere? It requires a hammer and it requires a chisel. I'm speaking from very minor experience here. And you have to chip away at it. When these people that chip carvings of stone, what's that thing in America? The four faces, the presidential faces. Do you know what? Sorry? Yeah. Mount Rushmore. Thank you, Richard. Yeah, Mount Rushmore. Wow, the chipping and the stonework that must have gone into that, and the mastery to get those wonderful... That's not working. To get that to, to look those faces took time and took ability, but it took a lot of work. There was a lot of chipping going on. The same goes with these bricks. Even though they're all shaped the same, it would have taken probably a machine, to be honest, but let's say if it was just done by a person, that would have been done with a hammer and a chisel to get that shaped, to knock off all the knobbly bits, to get it to this nice rectangle look that these bricks have got. And if a stone, that stone had feelings, it would have hurt. If he had nerve endings, that could have well hurt, yes? Turn with me to Hebrews, please, chapter 12. I'm going to read from 1 right through to 12. Now, I know that verses 1... to 2 have already been quoted this morning by Andy, and he used that as a visual pattern. Can I just say, me and Andy did not, it's Hebrews chapter 12. Andy and I had no idea that both of us were going to read from Hebrews today, chapter 12, okay? Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In your struggle against sin, you have not resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And you have forgotten that word of encouragement that addresses you as sons. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you. Because the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as sons. For what son is not disciplined by his father? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not true sons. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us and we respected them for it. how much more should we submit to the Father of our spirits and live? Our fathers disciplined us for a little while, as they thought best. But God disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. Therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. Make level paths for your feet, so that lame may not be disabled, but rather healed. Now, there's one word in there that went through the whole of that chapter that really stuck out for me this morning, to do with being a living stone being built into a house. And in today's society, that's a swear word almost. And I swore about four times by I can make out. And that's discipline. Discipline in our society is seen as a swear word almost. Now, as a parent, and those that here are parents, and those that have got at the moment little ones, and they're not quite got to the stage of my daughter of 6 and a half, discipline is something I very strongly believe in. Keris will not grow up to be a particularly nice person, I don't believe, if she's not shown some discipline. If she's not set straight. And sometimes I discipline her as a father. And maybe I'm not quite right in my discipline. That's telling her off, by the way. That's, you know, I'm not talking about, you know, locking her in a cupboard or doing anything nasty like that. I'm talking about telling her off. But if you notice, how did that reaction when I said discipline in some of your minds go? What was going through your mind? Because some people see discipline as, you know, might have memories of, I don't know, being caned at school. I know up until middle school, in my middle school, that was something that was very strongly believed in still. But that's been removed from our schools now. That's not allowed. Some people see discipline as harsh. But the word discipline is actually, in biblical terms, in God's terms, is actually a good thing. It's a required thing. And it's required of our children. It's also required of us. We, as adults, still need discipline. And this morning when I was preparing for this, the whole of this week, I felt God saying there are people here that he currently is disciplining. But he's disciplining for a reason. He's shaping the living stones that are in this spiritual house. And with some of us, and I include myself, as always, in all these things, some of us, he's got the hammer and chisel out, knocking off the bits that shouldn't be there. He's shaping us into the stone that can fit into the slot so that we can be built together as a spiritual house for his purposes and not for us. And some of us are going through that discipline at the moment. And it's painful. But it's one of these excellent encouragements. And I'm sorry, ladies, but it does say in the masculine. So please put the feminine in there for yourself. But it does say this. And you have forgotten that word of encouragement that addresses you as sons. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline. And do not lose heart when he rebukes you. Because the Lord disciplines those he... And again,
loves.
And he punishes everyone he accepts as a son or daughter. It's an encouragement. If you're going through discipline at the moment, it is an encouragement. And it feels very painful at the time, doesn't it? For those who've been through it or are going through it now, it feels painful. It hurts. Having the bad bits knocked off hurts. Being shaped into the people that God wants us to be because he knows what's best for us does hurt. But it's required so that this house that God wants to develop here in Greenford becomes the house that he wants it to be. It's almost the house that God built. Not the house that Jack built, but the house that God built. And some of us need shaping so we can fit into the whole. And that does require discipline. There are things in our lives that are not making us holy, and it needs to be knocked off. But it's a good thing in the end, because it says quite happily here in Hebrews that it is a good thing. It seems painful at the time. But God disciplines us for our good, it says in verse 10. That we may share in his... Read it to me, please. We share in his holiness. Because he's asking us to be a holy priesthood. We can't do that with the knobbly bits attached. Sorry, I've got this whole vision of bricks with bits that need in my head. And to give you an example where I'm getting that from, we've just had a fireplace removed in our back room, and the back boiler's been removed. And we've got this lovely red brick hearth that spreads into our back room. Well, there's now a brick missing from there, because when the back boiler got taken out, obviously there was a bit that, I don't understand how it worked. Anyway, it sat in there. There's a brick missing. And we've got to get a new brick, or get a brick, to get to fit into that hole. None of the bricks in my garden are going to fit properly. Some of them need chipping. I need to knock and chip them into place. So it fit. No, I got that wrong, actually. I'm going to get my dad to come round and to... I knew there was something wrong with that whole comment. I'll get my dad to come and knock. Well, actually, I'm going to get my father, that's a better analogy, to come and shape the brick so it can fit in the hole. And our Father is shaping us to fit into the right holes. But this shaping, when I'm talking about bricks for brick buildings, etc., and for my hearth, is about shaping on the outside, isn't it? And as I said, we're called to be a holy priesthood. And the priests were recognised by the garments they wore on the outside. Nobody really knew what was going on in the inside. And the same goes for us. Our God doesn't shape us on the outside. With my analogy earlier with Andy standing up here, physically, we're all different shapes and sizes. The same goes with our gifts. We're all different shapes and sizes with our gifts. But for me and Andy, you could see that we were different from the outside. But you have no idea what's going on in Andy or what's going on in me. On the inside. And our God shapes us on the inside. So then what pours out is what can be seen. He likes to shape the inside, not the outside. This is not cosmetic surgery by God. I want to look more handsome. Please shape my face better. I want to look physically more fit. Please give me better pecs and excellent thigh muscles, please. That's not our God. He does not worry about the outside. He's not worried about our physical looks. He's worried about our inward and what's us. I'm going to just put this on. Very misshapen piece of rock. Very ugly piece of rock, to be honest. It's not very attractive at all. Can you all see that, yeah? It's a very ugly piece of rock. Been sat in the mud for some time, I would suggest. Been sat underground a lot, and it's very dirty and very muddy. Doesn't look very much, does it? And that could be chipped and made and created into a brick. That could fit inside a building. But our God's not really worried about that. He's more worried about the inside. Don't roll off. He's worried about the inside. Can you see that, the inside of that? Okay, these are made up of little amethyst crystals. This is what God's doing in the inside of us when he disciplines us. He's making us shine with his light on the inside. I'm only using this purely as a physical, as a visual item. But this is what God is doing for us. You may not think you look particularly great on the outside, and you may know what's going on the inside, but actually when God's disciplining us, he's trying to make us shine with his light. And that only happens when we allow him to do that. Do you know how a geode is formed? This is a geode, by the way, if you didn't know what you understood, but this is a geode. How geodes are formed. They can be formed by many different ways. They can be formed by volcanoes, from the heat of a volcano. Or the other thing that I do like, from an animal's home. And it says, long after the animal has moved on, or the tree that it could well have been formed from has died and its roots have rotted away, mineral water flows in and out of the hollow space. And then just like a volcanic bubble, a wide variety of crystals are taking shape inside the animal's former home. When something has died, we need to die to ourselves. We know that, that's scriptural. When something has died, when we die to stuff in outside of us, God can work and beauty can come out. But that does require discipline. We have to be chipped and formed on the inside out. And we have to allow that to happen. Don't know about you, but whenever I was being disciplined by my parents, I used to feel so pain. I used to thought, woe is me, pity is me. Do you feel like that when you're being disciplined by God? Or do we recognise sometimes what discipline is? Sometimes we think bad things are happening to us, woe is me. But actually, we sometimes don't recognise that the fact that that is discipline from God. These bad things are allowed to happen. We're in these bad situations because God is trying to teach us something. People came surging forward for prayer, and I'm not knocking anybody coming forward for prayer from God. But sometimes I wonder if we're coming forward from prayer and going, and I'm not saying that was this morning, so please hear me very carefully, but I'm sometimes wondering if we're asking for prayer because something bad's going on in our life, and in the process of that, we're meant to be hearing God saying, my child whom I love, this is also, I need you to hear some discipline that's going on. Because I know what's best for you, and I want to create the best out of you that I originally formed you from. That lump of rock looked like nothing from the outside. Yet on the inside, what was going on was something very, very beautiful. But it took a lot of heat from, and something dying inside of it to make it cut into that being that beautiful. And water to be passing through it. And we know the analogy of water and the living spirit of God is like water passing through us. And that needs to happen to all of us. But that does require us to be disciplined by our loving Father. And discipline's not fun and it's not nice. But the greatest encouragement is, if you are being disciplined by God, it's because he loves you and you are classed as his child. Sometimes when I have to discipline, or Joy has to discipline Keris, we do make a point of, when she's listened and she's said sorry and all that, we do make a point of saying to her, we love you. And it's for your best that we do this. And God is saying that to some of us this morning. That he loves you. And the reason you're going through what you're going through is because he's your loving Father, disciplining you because he knows what's best for you. And for his spiritual house that he is forming. could have, with the whole of this morning, used the whole marathon analogy, but I didn't feel that God wanted to do that. He wanted to link everything to do with being a living stone. We're being blessed as a church at the moment. But for that to continue, holiness needs to continue within each and every one of us. We have an individual and corporate responsibility to make sure we're focused on the Jesus, who is the true cornerstone, as it says in verse 4. No, 6. But it says he is the living stone that we are to focus on and take everything from, our knowledge and our teaching from. And if we don't do that, the house is not going to stand, is it? And we are asked to do that. In my laid up, being on my bad back yesterday on the sofa, I got slightly bored, and I apologise, but as I came to, I decided to watch something on one of the digital channels, and it was Homes from Hell. And it didn't really hit me until this morning that one of the scenes was a corner of a house had got washed away, the corner bit. Underneath, the corner stone that held it got washed away. The whole house then collapsed and got washed away. We, church, have to make sure we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, on the cornerstone, and take everything from him. So if you are being disciplined at the moment, take it. It's from a loving Father who wants the very best for you and for us. We sung that song, Consuming Fire. Have your way with me. How many of us really understood the word of have your way with me? Consuming fire means removing all impurities. Have your way with me means being chipped at. Is allowing God to reshape us. Are you willing to be that living stone? Allowing him to reshape you. Joy's going to come and play Consuming Fire, just that chorus. I don't want us to sing it, but I just want us to sit for a bit and talk to God. Puts it like this: my dear child, don't shrug off God's discipline, but don't be crushed by it either. It's the child he loves that he disciplines, the child he embraces, he also corrects. Just at the moment, let me encourage you, if you feel like you are being disciplined at the moment, if you feel like that's going on, just give that up to God and just say, have your way. If you want to respond to God, if you want to say, yeah, have your way, Lord, then, and this is, I want you to only respond to this because you know that you're going through some situations with God. That you think, yeah, actually God's focusing on me here, pointing some stuff out that he has been doing for some time and I've not been listening properly. It's not about guilt tripping or anything like that, but if you want to respond to God and you want to just raise your hand, that's fine. Nobody else is really looking at you. Everybody's dealing with their own stuff. But just sometimes it's good to acknowledge that before God. So I said to you, a brick house, you can see when things are going wrong with it. Spiritual house, sometimes it's easy to cover it up.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.